Hi, my name is Brad, and I'm the pastor at Community Fellowship. Thank you so much for tuning in to this online gathering. What you're going to see today is people worshiping God with great music and listening to teaching from the Bible that will help them live their lives. And we're excited about the fact that you're joining with us in that. If you have any questions, please ask them. If you have statements to make, make comments. And if you think this could help people around you, share this video so that others may join us. Thank you so much for being a part of this. I'll come back and see you again in the middle and the end of the video.
If you all stand with us, please, and let's worship the Lord together.
There's no space that His love can't reach. There's no place where we can't find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. Take me in with Your arms spread wide. Take me in like an orphan child. Never let go, never leave my side. That His love can reach. There's no place where we can't find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. I am holding on to You. I am holding on to You. In the middle of the storm, I'm holding on. I am
the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, He is my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, He is my song. You are good. Good, oh, You are good, good. let the King of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves. Oh, he is my song. Let the King of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. Let the King of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves. Oh, he is my song. Let the King of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. You are good, good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh, and you are good, good. Oh, and you are good, good. Oh,
you're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down.
You are good, you're good. Oh, and you are good, good. Oh, and you are good, good. Oh,
never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down.
Amen. Wow, great job, you guys. You can be seated if you'd like. rest your legs for a moment. It has been a very good week for us as a church. Last Sunday was Easter. We celebrated with two crowds full of people in both gatherings. The 915 was actually larger than the 11 last week, which is abnormal and strange. We had so many guests. If you were a guest with us last week and have come back this week, then welcome. We're so glad that you're here. I hope you have a wonderful experience. Now, today is the Sunday nationally known to pastors as yearly low attendance Sunday. That is the week after Easter. I'm going to explain it to you, okay? All of the once a monthers came last week. All of the once every other weekers, last week. So you guys, you're the core. You know what I mean? You are the core. You're sitting there thinking, I'm more dedicated to church than I realized. I came on nationally low attendance Sunday. I came that day. You did. You should smile, look in the mirror, feel proud of yourself today. I appreciate you. We're so glad that you're here. I hope you have a great, great day. This week, we also had something called Secret Church. Friday night, about 50 or so people from His House Church and our church gathered together in Mayfield, and they studied the Bible for 6 straight hours. It was such an amazing time. We also prayed very intensely for believers in Somalia and in throughout Eastern Africa. That was kind of the secret part of the Secret Church event. I was blown away with joy. It was such a great night. The majority of people stayed all the way until it was over. It was just a good experience. And so next year, we'll do it again. I encourage you to consider being a part of that. It's just really, really worth your time. And if you'll talk to somebody who went this year, you'll find out. This year, we went from the first verse in Genesis to the last verse in Revelation with the topic of prayer and fasting, and we went through every book of the Bible, Old and New Testament. David Platt's one of the world's greatest Bible teachers who taught that night, did just an exceptional job. So it's a very good thing worth being excited about. Today, you are here today, and today we are going to honor some leaders who've given large amounts of their time and their emotion and their passion to this church and to things that matter here. And so we'll do that at the end of the gathering. You can prepare your heart and get ready for that. It's a good moment. It was such a kind of a tearjerker in the first gathering, and I think you're going to enjoy that celebration as well. And we're also kicking off a new teaching series today. So lots of exciting things happening. I'm glad you're here, and I'm glad that you're going to experience what happens today. Would you pray with me? And then we'll stand back to our feet and worship the Lord. Lord, we honor you, and we honor those who serve you. We honor you, and we honor those who dedicate their lives to your vision, your mission, your passions. Today, Lord, as we dive into the topic of starting over, I pray that you'd give us an extra special amount of grace, obviously from you to us, but also for us, so that we might be able to look into our own struggles, our own mishaps, our own failures, our own endings, and see how it is that you might work as we start over. We trust you in all things and in all ways, and it is our privilege to worship you today. Amen.
If you would stand back to your feet. I am not skilled to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at his right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take him at his word and deed. Christ died to save me, this I read. And in my heart I find a need of him to be my Savior. That he would leave his place on high and come for sinful man to die. You call it strange, so once did I. Before I knew my Savior, my Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be. Yes, living, dying, let me breathe. My strength, my solace from the spring. That he who lives to be my king once died to be my Savior. That he would leave his place on high and come for sinful man to die. You call it strange, so once did I. Before I knew my Savior, my Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be.
My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior loves, my Savior lives.
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step You were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much You've done, knowing every victory is Your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone, never once did You leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, You are faithful. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much You've done, knowing every victory is Your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone, never once did You leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, You are faithful. You are faithful, God, You are faithful. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone. Carried by Your constant grace, held within Your perfect peace, never once, no, we never walk alone. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did You leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, You are faithful. Every step we are breathing in Your grace. Evermore we'll be breathing out Your praise. You are faithful, God, You are faithful. You are faithful, God, You are faithful. We know You are faithful, God, You are faithful.
God. God, we thank you this morning that you are faithful to us, that you will never leave us and never forsake us and never give up on us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Great job, you guys. I told Brent earlier, so one of the things I love about it when he leads worship is we're similar age, and there's so many young folks in our church that that not everybody remembers the same songs I remember and loves the same songs I remember from the late 90s and the early 2000s. And My Savior Loves, that is a great song, man. That is a great song. I really appreciate you letting us sing it this morning. So you guys, today is a good day, and I'm excited to be here and talk to you about things that I think is, there's beautiful truth here, but also there is kind of the admission of challenge and failure in the process. So you can't talk about starting over without mentioning what it means not to have gotten where you meant to go. You know, like there's some sort of assumed problem, you know, if you're having to start over, right? And so this is our new series. For the next 4 weeks, we'll be dealing with the topic of what it means to begin again, to start over, to start fresh, to turn over a new leaf, to make a new attempt, to get back on the wagon, to do whatever it is that you're facing or challenging in this topic. And I want to just kind of give credit where credit is due. Not so often, but every now and then, I will utilize some stuff that another pastor has put together where I just personally grew from their words. And Pastor Andy Stanley in Atlanta, Georgia, originally wrote a book called Starting Over, and then that became a sermon series. And with that church's permission, we are using the graphics that they used for things. And even of the four sermons, one of them, I'm using his outline. I just think that he did a good job and things. So adding to it a little more scripture than Andy tends to use, and we'll do that. But ultimately, this is something that we want to give some credit there where it comes from. So let's do this. Let's dive right in. Let's pray together, and then we'll get started. Lord, we trust you. It is a beautiful thing to know you and to realize that right now, Lord, I am speaking to the God who created the universe. And you are hearing us, and not just my voice, but the intentionalized thoughts, the prayers of each person in this room, our concerns, our cares, our worries, our celebrations, even our guilt. Lord, you are aware. And you're hearing that, and you're noticing, and you're not only aware, but you're active. And you're active in front of us, not as a response to us, but Lord, our action is a response to you. So we trust you, and we thank you for being active in our lives. We pray that today would be a day when we learn some things from your word, and from experience, and from teaching, and that your spirit would guide us today, Lord, through your word as it becomes part of our life. We trust you, Jesus. Amen. Starting Over, subtitle for the series is how to ensure that the next time isn't like the last time, okay? So this is a bit of a different series for us. I have a tendency to take a section of scripture and teach that section of scripture or a particular theme in scripture and teach that. And in this topic, we're being a little more like counseling from the pulpit, kind of thinking through how does this affect your life. Our hope is to be extremely practical over the next 4 weeks. And it is a stretch for me. And so I'm excited about doing it, but I'm also just confessing to you that this is not normally the way that I go about preaching. So this, for me, is a kind of a time of learning and a somewhat of a beginning again as well. And it doesn't matter where you're starting new, but all of us have a tendency to find ourselves starting over. So by show of hands, how many of you would say that in the last, say, 10 years of your life, you have started over in some way and somewhere, new job, new relationship, new educational goals, new church, new something, right? Starting over. And starting over, depending upon your personality, to some is like really exciting, and to some is really daunting, to some is really exhausting, right? Downright scary sometimes. And so we're going to talk about this. As a pastor, I have had a front row seat to the lives of thousands of people over the last 26 years in watching people start over. And I got to tell you, in a certain percentage of those, that is the most exciting thing I'm ever going to get to do, is to watch life change. We were singing the song earlier, My Savior Loves, My Savior Lives. This isn't really part of the sermon, but I got to tell you, there's a guy that used to go to church with me that used to sing that song. His name is Terry. And when I met Terry the first time, Terry was, his wife had just left him, and he was really fond of Jack Daniels, and he loved playing guitar. And that were the three things pretty much he would tell you about himself, right? Like that was him, you know? And he walked into a church plant band practice with a guitar in each hand, and he said, "I hear you guys need a picker." And we said, "We actually do need a picker. Like, come on in, man." He had a mullet, and he wore a hat of his favorite NASCAR driver for about 20 years. Same hat every day, right? And the brother could play the guitar and sing, and for months he was on our praise team and didn't know Jesus. Didn't know Jesus at all. Liked playing guitar. Loved being a part of the team. And there came a day, I don't have time for the whole story, but he was literally sitting on a bar stool at a place where he intended to go get rid of his sorrows. And Jesus spoke to him. And he walked up, he paid his tab, he went out to his car, he sat down, and he called me. And he said, "How do you know when Jesus is talking to you?" And I said, "What'd he say?" And he said, "You don't want to know." And I said, "Actually, I do know." He said, "No, I really don't think I can tell you." And I said, "All right." And he did tell me, and I'm really glad to know, but I can't tell you, okay? So that's what he said. And that young man came to Christ sitting in his car in the parking lot of a bar in Paducah and met Jesus. And a few years later, that was a song he sang and would lead us to sing. And when he would sing it, I had no doubt that there was truth to his story, right? Starting over. Sometimes you get to see those stories. You get to see, like, front row seat, see people's lives begin again, and then all the amazing stuff that comes from it, right? All the amazing stuff that comes from it. In particular, that particular guy met a single mom a few years later. They got married. They got baptized together before that happened. She gave him a new NASCAR hat at his baptism. I kid you not. Like it was... It was symbolic, and it worked, and he went from a black hat to a white hat. I can't make this stuff up. Like, that's exactly what happened, okay? It was, both of them were Earnhardt, but besides that, it was a black one and a white one. And he started over. How do we ensure that the next time isn't like the last time, right? That's what we're looking into. And not only have I had the front row seat to see this happen in people's lives, but quite frankly, more than I ever would have expected, starting over has been a part of my life. You know, as a young man, I was very driven. I knew what I thought I wanted. I knew how I was going to get there, the educational process, the steps to be taken, how to build the resume. Like, I knew how to do all of those things. And I did all those things, and I just never really thought I would look back. You know, I never really thought I would go, I took the wrong path. You know, never really thought I would fall and in some way fail. That was not even in my mind. And if you've ever been young, right? I know some of you are there now, and some of you remember it, and some of you are told you once were. That's funnier than people thought. The people for whom it should have been funny didn't get it. That's okay. So the truth is, when you're young, you have a tendency to think that life is going to go your way, exactly the way you want it every time. And you don't really prepare for what happens when it doesn't, right? What happens when this is not where I thought I would end up and you find yourself starting over, okay? So this whole series for the next four weeks is for you and about you and intended to be helpful with you. A couple of observations that have been made. One of them is we tend to learn from our mistakes in the small things. Like in little things, we are good at learning from our mistakes. Like the first time you ever played poker with someone and they knew what they were doing and you didn't, right? And then you realize, I will never go all in with two threes ever again. I've learned my lesson. It was an expensive lesson. I will not do that. I will never experience that again. I now know, right? I now know. I remember the first time. I love dogs. You guys know that. I've been bitten like 14 times in the training process. And with every one of those times, I now know something I'll never do again. Like that was a pretty simple thing. Okay, don't do that, or you'll get bit, right? You guys have done this as well, right? You've learned, whether it's picking up a new hobby or developing an ability to do a certain dance step or to sing a certain song or to play a particular instrument or to handle something with with your family or with cooking a particular dinner, with knowing how to sew something or how to make something or how to paint something. Like, you've learned from your mistakes in the small things and you've decided, I'll not do that again. I'll do that differently next time. In the small things, we have a tendency to learn from our mistakes. But oftentimes, as human beings, it's just the opposite in the big things. In the big things, we tend to repeat our mistakes for whatever reason and in the areas that matter most. We repeat our mistakes in our relationships. We tend to repeat our mistakes with our finances. We tend to repeat our mistakes with our jobs, with our employers. We tend to repeat our mistakes. And so what we want to do over the next 4 weeks is deal with this process of practical growth in the life of a human being, learning how it is that we might move away from repeating our mistakes and let God guide us into a place that brings him greater senses of honor and helps us just simply get better, okay? So in our parenting, in our finances, in our education related to our work, we want to learn how not to repeat our mistakes. Because here's the question we all end up asking ourselves. When will I learn? Have you ever looked in a mirror and asked that question? Like, mad at yourself, disappointed, frustrated at yourself about something? When will I learn? Why am I doing this? I'm going to let you in on something. Even if you've not asked this of yourself, other people have asked that question about you. When will they learn? When will he learn? Would you agree with me that it's often easier to have that kind of epiphany about someone else's life than it is your own? Like, to go, why is she so stupid? Why does she keep doing that? Why does that guy keep doing that dumb thing over and over? Why can't he learn? Like, you've asked this about your family member, your friend, your neighbor, your spouse, maybe. You've asked that question. Today, we're asking the question, when will I learn? When will I learn? And it's a question that we have to be willing to ask ourselves, not just from an emotional, throw your hands in the air, frustrated about yourself kind of way, but I mean more of a practical, pragmatic, intentional, when will I learn, right? How am I going to do this? Because I want to start over. It's time to start over. It's time to start over in a way that the next time is better than the last time. Starting over. Now, before we really go into this or get any further, we have to acknowledge the reality of the emotions that we feel when we're in that place of starting over, when we're there. Now, sometimes it's a really exciting thing. Like, where you were was so painful and so problematic that you feel like you've escaped it. And so now to start over feels refreshing and exciting. But more often than not, what we're doing is measuring where we were, seemed to be good, and then something went wrong and we lost it. And now we're starting over and it doesn't feel exciting. It feels scary. It feels exhausting. I try to decide which of the personal stories in my life I was going to share with you today, and there are several of embarrassing, disappointing moments of starting over in my life. But there's one I think that was quite emotional that I hope communicates. In 2006, late 2006, it would have been about October or November, I think, maybe early 2007, I was sitting in a deli in downtown Paducah. And it's one of my favorite places to eat. I was there with the staff from the church that I led. There were 7 or 8 of us there that day eating lunch together. And we were all celebrating because the week before I had mailed off and turned in my final copy of my dissertation. Now, not telling you this to make myself look good. I'm telling you this to build up the reality of what's about to happen to me in this story, okay? For me, here's what education looked like. 4 years of college, 4 years of master's degree. That was a full-time thing. It was like going to college twice. And then a 3-year doctorate. That was the process. So I spent 2 years in the classroom and the 3rd year writing. And then when I was writing, I had to turn something in every month. And they would grade it and send it back to me, and I'd have to send it, you know, and I just kept going and kept going till it was a full book, which is what they call the dissertation. So I had turned it in. The way that process works is you have an advisor who tells you whether or not your work is good enough. And he's supposed to be mean. Like, that's the goal. Be a jerk. Tell me what's wrong. Use your red ink pen. That's what you're supposed to do. And I got a nice one, not a mean one, you know? And so here's what had happened. I had turned in my dissertation. I was feeling this sense of finish line, like I'm done. Like, I've been a full-time student since I was five, and I'm now in my upper 20s. You know what I mean? Like, I'm sorry. I was in my early 30s. Now, in my early 30s, for the first time ever, I'm not going to be a student anymore. I am done. I am done. Like, I'm, can you, like, that's exciting. Like, I'm finished. And so I've turned it in. I digitally emailed a copy. Yes, we had email back then. And then I mailed a copy, like a formal printed out copy, and it was going to be done. And I was sitting there at lunch at my favorite deli with the entire staff. They were buying my lunch to celebrate that I was graduating, and my cell phone rang. And I took the phone call outside. And 30 minutes later, they came looking for me, and they found me sitting on the bricks around the Market House Theater crying. And I just couldn't see them, because the phone call was from the school telling me that I wasn't going to graduate, that my paper wasn't good enough, and that I had to start over, like as in from scratch. There was a flaw in my topic that did not quite meet the parameters, and my advisor had not caught it, and I had to start over. They fired my advisor, by the way, which at the time I celebrated. I probably shouldn't have. It was not the best moment for me. But I sat there in brokenness, and for a week or 2 weeks, I don't remember, I just couldn't fathom the thought of trying again. I couldn't fathom. There were 18 people in my class, only six of us graduated, and five of them graduated that time. And then there was me. And then there were 13 others that ended up not graduating. And so I was in this spot in the middle where I had to decide whether or not I was going to start over. And so, long story short, I did start over. And 6 months later, I did graduate, and it happened. And that ended up being a really good thing for me, but it did not feel good that day at all. It felt horrible. I'm telling you all that to say that starting over is going to vary in the way that you feel at the moment that you feel like you're taking your first step, right? Whether you feel like you've escaped something you're finally out of and you get to start over, or you've lost something that you dearly loved and now you have to start over, okay? And so today's goal is to talk to you about starting over. I looked through the scripture, scoured the scripture, looking for stories of starting over, and I thought it might be hard, but what I find is that nearly every famous biblical character has a story of starting over. All of them, like probably 80% of all the names of people that you know who exist in more than one chapter of the Bible, like they started over at some point, and so I get to just pick from them. There are many. There are a couple of things that seem to be fairly normal in almost all of those stories. And even though this is not really a word I like to use in sermons, I think it speaks well for today, so I'm going to. In every one of those situations, it's like after someone fails or loses or falls, and then they go through a period and then they start over, they come to a new place, it seems that they have this new sense of divine destiny and abiding humility. Divine destiny meaning they found their purpose again, right? Like their purpose in bringing glory to God, their purpose in doing a particular thing, their purpose in filling the role that needs to be filled that's in their future, okay? And this abiding humility, it's not a moment of humility, it's like something that finally stuck with them. And now they're going to live life continually in the future, and as a whole, you're going to see them now be humble. That's why, for instance, a lot of our failures come young in life, because we're not humble, we're cocky and smart. We know what we're going to do, we're definitely going to accomplish it, right? And faster than the other guy. And then we fall short, stop, and find ourselves having to work through the journey of starting over, only hopefully now to have this sense of abiding humility that helps you realize that your success is not about you. It's about other things that are outside of your control. And so here's the story of Moses. If we would consider the story of Moses being one of many examples. Moses was born a slave, but he was raised a king, right? And even though he walked like an Egyptian and talked like an Egyptian, He was not an Egyptian. Some of you wanted to laugh, but you didn't want people to know you were old enough to know that. He exits his Egyptian life for the life of a peasant at first. He goes from being heir to a king, you know, a king's role, living in a wealthy mansion, to being homeless and alone. In the process of doing this, he defends one of his brethren, a Hebrew man, against an Egyptian man and commits murder. And then he flees for his life from his adopted father figure in the king there, in Pharaoh, and he finds himself gone. And then, before you know it, he finds a new family in Midian with his would-be eventual father-in-law and his potential eventual wife. And while tending the flock, one time he notices a bush that's burning. And from this moment where God speaks, not just to Moses, but to all humanity, where God reveals his own name to us, the I Am, right? Which is probably a much bigger deal than what most of us give it credit. All of a sudden, Moses develops this divine sense of direction or calling from God and a humility that goes with it. And he starts with plague number one, or warning number one. The Pharaoh says no, the plague happens, he's done. God sends him a second time, and then it doesn't work, and he's done. And a third time, and it doesn't work, and he's done. And a fourth time, and it doesn't work, and he's done. And eventually Moses has to be thinking, how many times am I going to try this that it doesn't work? Well, the answer is 10. On the 10th attempt, after God has sent him to Pharaoh to speak, let my people go, Pharaoh says no again, and God strikes down the firstborn of Pharaoh's kingdom. In response, Pharaoh runs the people out of his country. So he gifts them their freedom by force. And then Moses sees other things. Moses sees the parting of the Red Sea, and he sees thousands of people cross on dry ground. Moses sees God bring down the Ten Commandments. Moses sees God bring manna from heaven to feed the hungry. That's bread from heaven. Moses sees God bring water from a rock. You see what I'm saying? That shouldn't have happened. Over and over and over, Moses sees God do all of these things. And so you would think probably that Moses is now in this place where he goes, okay, I've got this. I now know what I'm doing. I've got it handled. I am the leader. I was meant to be. And I can accomplish it. And so the story that I'm going to read to you today is a bit of an unknown story. It's not talked about quite as often as any of the things I've mentioned so far. But Moses brings all of the people into an area. He has them surround him. And he does what he calls judge them. In other words, they bring him problems and he says, this is the answer. So a married couple comes up to him and he says, Moses, she's wrong. And she says, Moses, he's wrong. And obviously Moses goes, the guy's right. Then moves on. And another person says, this is my disagreement. And so Moses defends them. Okay, you're right and you're wrong. And over, he starts leading with power. You're right and you're wrong. And then this happens. Moses' father-in-law said to him, what you are doing is not good, which is what every married man wants his father-in-law to say to him. You're wrong. You did it wrong. You and the people that you will certainly wear yourselves out, for this thing is too heavy for you. You are not able to do it alone. Now obey my voice. I will give you advice, and God will be with you. You shall represent the people before God and bring their cases to God. He goes on to describe exactly how he should do this in the next verse. He says, and you shall warn them about the statutes and the laws, and you shall make them know the way in which they must walk and what they must do. Moreover, look for able men from the people, men who fear God, who are trustworthy, who hate bribes, and place such men over the peoples as chiefs of thousands, of hundreds, of fifties, and of tens. And let them judge the people at all times. Every great matter they shall bring to you, but any small matter they shall decide themselves. So it will be easier for you, and they will bear the burden with you. If you do this, God will direct you. You will be able to endure, and all this people also will go to their place in peace. Will go to their place in peace. So here's what happens. Moses works through all of these amazing things and finally gets to a place where he's confident that he's leading, and God sends his father-in-law to say, you can't handle it. You can't do it. You're not big enough, bold enough, strong enough. You're going to have to start over. You're going to have to start over. Get some other people involved, bring them in, build teams, develop a plan, make sure you can entrust things to them, give away authority, and move forward, because this is far too heavy for you. And Moses has to start again. He has to start again. I don't know about you, but I assume, I know in my life, God has regularly had to show me that I'm not enough. Regularly have to remind me that if I take this on myself, I will fall. Usually, he tells me that when I've fallen. Like I'm, you know, face to the ground, and he goes, I want you to understand, you can't do this. You're going to have to start over. Start over. Start over. Start over. And little by little, what is happening is that God is teaching us to entrust him with authority, to entrust him with direction, to entrust him with life, so that in the long run, we are living a life that's obedient to him, not a life where we are trying to achieve something for him. It's a big difference. So, to help us with today and for the rest of the series, what I thought we would do today is look at three myths that we tend to believe about starting over. Three things that are almost true. The problem is, if you think they are true, that they can really lead you down the wrong path. The first myth is the experience myth. The idea is this: experience makes me wiser. Experience makes me wiser. Well, the truth is this: experience makes you older. Experience makes you more bitter. Experience can make you tired. That's what experience can make you. Experience can make you hard, right? Experience can do lots of things, but experience in and of itself does not make you wiser. What the scripture will teach us is that when I evaluate my experiences, it can make me wiser. So it's actually the evaluation of those experiences, not just having those experiences. Many people are experienced. I've been through a lot. Okay, what have you been through? Well, it happened this way, and then it happened this way, and then it happened this way. And I say, so guy, what are you telling me? He goes, well, I've had five women in my life, and they were all crazy. I don't know, what is wrong with them? I go, I have an idea. I can tell you what the one thing they all have in common is. You. Dude, it might be you. You might be the thing. And he's like, I never thought about that. See, experience doesn't make you wiser. An evaluated experience makes you wiser. Here's what the scripture says in the book of Romans. Romans 12, 1 and 2 says, I appeal to you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual form of worship. Now, I want to stop there and just say, it's so important that we get what we're reading here. He is describing how a Christ follower handles pain, okay? How a Christ follower handles challenge and pain. So let me ask you this question before we go any further. Would you agree with me that even if you did everything right in life all the time, there would still be pain, right? So like even if you were the smartest, wisest, most intelligent, level emotionally, never get overwhelmed, never get out of your own head, never get in your own head, like you are just handling life well, you're still going to experience pain, right? People are going to sin against you. People you love are going to get hurt. People are going to experience illness. You know, you're not always going to get everything you want. Sometimes people are going to pick other people over you. Like, that's going to happen, and you're going to experience pain. So what's happening here in Romans is that God is telling us through the writer Paul that we are living sacrifices. We're going to get cut. We're going to bleed. We're going to experience a challenge. And as we do so, we are supposed to present that life to God as spiritual worship. In other words, I am going through this life for you. But then he describes in the next verse what that can look like. He says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect." In a very plain and straightforward way, God is saying, don't waste your pain. Let it grow you. Let it mature you. Let it teach you. Let God use your experiences to transform you and renew your mind. Or you can just be hurt and angry. You can just be hurt and bitter. You can just be hurt and difficult. You know, you can do that. Either way, hurt is going to happen. The challenge is, will you live life trying to defend yourself from pain and therefore dedicate life to your own comfort? Or will you live life willing to be a sacrifice, a living sacrifice, so that as you live, you are open to God growing and maturing and renewing who you are? You see, we don't just want to have experiences. We want experiences to be the tool of God to grow our mind so that as we experience pain, we're learning. As we experience challenge, we're growing. As we experience disappointment, we're becoming more mature in our faith. And we're relying on God in a greater way. We don't want to be conformed to this world. In other words, we don't want to let this world make us what it can make us. But we want to make sure that living in this world has the effect that God wants it to have, so that I'm growing, maturing, and developing as I test and discern what's happening in my life. The truth is, evaluated experience can make you wiser. The next myth is, there's the know better myth. In other words, since I know better, I will do better. Since I know better, I will do better. The assumption here is that the reason we mess up is that we didn't realize it was bad. We didn't realize it was a problem. But now I know better. Now I know better, so don't worry. I will do better. When you were a teenager and your mother or father kept telling you the same truth over and over, what you wanted to do was look your mom in the eye and go, "I get it. I know." Right? I know. But what your parents were old enough to know is that it doesn't matter that you know. What matters is, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? Right? What are you going to do? And there's a very important theological thought that needs to happen here. You see, there's a gigantic difference between what I'm going to call today, the difference between being biblically guided Christians and being Christian humanists. You're thinking, what is a Christian humanist? Let me say what I mean here. A Christian humanist might be a perspective that says, God is going to tell me right and wrong, and then I'm going to live with those rules. And if I'm going to do well, it's because I'm going to do right. So I will earn my own goodness. I will earn my own success. I will do better. I will become holy. I will, in my own power, my own strength, accomplish what God told me I had to do. And a lot of folks who think that they're biblical-minded Christians are actually Christian humanists, because they go to church, they hear a sermon, and then they go out in the world thinking, I'm going to do it, 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 I'm going to do it. And what they don't realize is that without the power of the Holy Spirit moving and working in them, they can't do it. See, there's a gigantic difference between knowing and doing, or knowing and not even being able to do. This is a perfect example. Every person that I know who's gone through serious addiction have moments where they say, I know better. I know better. I know better. I'm never going to drink again. I know better. I'm never going to smoke that again. I know better. I'm never going to inject that again. I know better. I'm never going to take that pill again. I know better. But then in every addict's story, what do? They take that pill again. They inject that thing again. They smoke that thing again. They drink that thing again. Because knowing better does not automatically equal doing better. Knowing better does not automatically equal doing better. In fact, knowing better doesn't guarantee that you even have the ability to do better. Some of you have been in a place where you felt crippled to the reality of doing what you knew was right. Right? The Apostle Paul did. Shouldn't be too odd to think that many of us do as well, or all of us. The Apostle Paul in the 7th chapter of Romans describes his identity as saying, even though I know what is right, I end up doing what is wrong. Even though I pray and want and desire not to do what is wrong, that's exactly what I end up finding myself doing. So there was no shortage of ethical understanding. Paul knew what was right. But he realized that in his own strength and in his own power, he was often powerless to overcome the temptation. Knowing better doesn't automatically equal doing better at all. Let's read in the next chapter. Chapter 7 is where he tells us about the pain, but in chapter 8, he describes the overcoming power of the Spirit. He says, likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. Praise God, isn't that awesome? The Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. For we do not know what we ought to pray or how we ought to pray, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts, that's the Spirit, okay? He who searches hearts knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. You see, we don't just want to say, I know better, therefore I will do better. The truth is, now that I know better, what must I do differently? And this begins with an overwhelming reliance on the power of God in your life and not relying on your own abilities. Some of us are so disappointed that we can't impress God in our own strength. And what God is seeking is a man or woman who finally recognizes that. That I can't impress God in my own strength. There's no good in me without him. And so I will embrace him. And it's in my trust for him and my reliance on him and my need for him that any good will come from me or for you. Not, we have to not only know what's better, but we have to know what will you need to do differently or think differently or feel differently. Now, I'm going to just chase a rabbit for a second and say one of the things that we have to know about how to do differently is not only to not sin, but also to recognize not putting ourselves in a place where sin becomes high potential. You guys know what I mean, right? There's a difference between sinning and putting yourself in a place where sin becomes likely. As a teenager, I didn't always understand that. There were lots of times I thought, well, I'm not going to do anything wrong, so it's fine if I'm in a place where everybody else is. You guys got invited to some of those parties, didn't you? I saw a few of you there, right? Figuratively, not literally. I remember one particular time, I'm making confession here, my parents are in the room. I'm not sure they know this story, but I'm older now. I convinced them that I needed to go to a party. I think I was in eighth grade, I might have been a freshman. And what I did, what you do in those situations is you highlight all the good kids who are going to be there, right? Joey's going to be there, Cindy, she's going to be there. You know, Fred, he's going to be there. And my parents went, okay, well, that sounds fine. That sounds good. Those are good kids. Yeah, not so much. We went to this house. There was music playing. They were doing lots of stuff. I looked around. I wasn't doing anything wrong. I wasn't drinking. I wasn't smoking anything. I wasn't doing anything like that. There was some of that going on around me at this party, mostly among people I didn't know and I wasn't that close to. But then all of a sudden, there started to develop ideas. Hey, watch this. Like, we should go do this. And then out of nowhere, someone brought a large case of toilet paper. You know where this is going, don't you? And in that particular subdivision lived everyone's least favorite teacher. We have a lot of teachers here. I should have thought about that before I told this story. So in our eighth grade attitude, everybody took toilet paper and they went to this man's house. Now, I didn't do it. I was there. I said, I'm going to go watch, but I'm not. My dad's a teacher. I'm not going to toilet paper a teacher's house and get caught. I will die. Like, there's no way I'm doing it. But I'm here, so I might as well watch. So I go with them, and I'm standing in the street, and I'm watching, right? I'm watching, and they are throwing. All of a sudden, this gray house turns white, and this house made of rock becomes very soft on the outside, right? It's everywhere. It's all over trees, yards, over the roof, all around everything. And I'm standing there. I'm still not doing it. I haven't done a thing other than observe and be present. That's all I've done. And then guess what happens next? This red and blue light on top of a car starts swirling, and a deputy sheriff pulls up beside the house. And I, realizing I've not done anything wrong, decide I need to run. So I ran as hard as I could, and I jumped into a ditch, and I hid, okay? And then some other people said, like, Brad's hiding there. Let's go hide with him. Like, thank you. Bring the whole crowd. That's great. So they all have toilet paper in their hands. So they come and they hide with me in the ditch where I'm hiding. And then the one guy decides it would be funny to throw the toilet paper at the police officer. And he did. Now, luckily, I got out of the ditch, I ran around the corner, I went back to the house where I was supposed to be, and I did not leave the rest of the night. And I never got in any trouble. And to this day, I will tell you, I did not throw a single roll of paper. But was it smart for me to be in the middle of that? No, it wasn't smart for me to be in the middle. Was it wise for me to be in the middle of that? Absolutely not. Could I have found myself? I know you're thinking, that's just a little mischief. It's not that big of a deal. I'm using it as much as a metaphor as anything, that it's easy to put yourself in a place where you're thinking, I'm not going to do anything wrong, and you might find yourself ultimately guilty by association or actually doing things you never thought you would do because you let yourself walk right up to the edge, right? So we have to begin to listen to the direction and the guidance internally of the Holy Spirit to empower us to make good decisions and put ourselves in the right place. The first myth is the myth that I'm going to have experience that will make me wiser. No, you need to evaluate those. The second one is that I know better, so therefore I will do better. No, don't trust yourself that much. Trust the Lord. And the third thing is this myth, the time myth. Time is working against me. We say things like, I have to start over fast. I'm not getting any younger. You know, these wrinkles are getting deeper. I'm getting older. The gray hair is growing more. I need to rush. I need to hurry. And so here's what ends up happening is we take someone who's struggling with defeat internally. We take someone who's struggling with their own self-worth and their own value issues. We take someone whose spiritual equilibrium is a bit out of balance because of the pain they've recently experienced, and then we tell them to hurry. Hurry. Have you ever played the game where you're racing and you run like 50 yards and then you take a baseball bat and you put it on the ground and you run circles around it about 50 times and then you try to run back to the starting game? If you haven't ever done that, you should try that. It's hilarious. You should let someone else videotape it, and then you should let me have the video. But here's what happens is for whatever reason, we put ourselves in a place where we think that at our weakest moment, we somehow need to hurry. We need to hurry. And in the long run, we end up hurrying ourselves back into things without the wisdom that we just had the opportunity to develop, right? And then we go, when will I ever learn? See, time is your friend. Time is not against you. Time is for you. Time is a gift from God. I understand that you might be feeling lonely or having worry or concerns. And I understand that it seems like taking your time is wasting time or losing time. But God has gifted us time to your advantage. Time is what God uses to help move you in the right direction. The nature of pain and brokenness and sin in the human life is such that when you are hurting and when I am hurting, we have a tendency to become more self-absorbed. Think of it this way. When you have a headache, do you have more or less patience? Right? Less patience, right? If you have a migraine, are you ready to sit down and have someone tell you their daily chores and stories? No, you want them to shut up and leave you alone because you're hurting. Right? That's true of emotional pain. This is true of relational struggles, that when we're going through pain, we have a tendency to self-focus and become a little more self-absorbed. And when we do so, if we don't give that moment enough time to allow ourselves to overcome and deal with the pain, then what we'll do is decide what we do next from a self-absorbed perspective. Self-absorbed people make self-absorbed decisions. But when you are healthy and when you are rested and when you have had time, what happens is God gives you clarity, that divine destiny that I mentioned earlier. And with clarity and with humility,
you can take the kind of time that you need to make the right decision. When you have clarity, you won't make such bad decisions. You see, when you're hurting, there are things you might need to hear that you're not listening to. When you're hurting, there are things you might need to understand, but you're not presently calculating, okay? When you're hurting, the tendency is to want the pain to go away, and that's understandable. And that's why God gives us the gift of time. The slide that was up earlier will tell you this, and I'll say it again, is that time is our friend. Time is God's classroom. It's God's healing space. This is where God is helping us get what we should get from what we just went through. Okay? This is what we're learning. This is our time. And I know it never happens as quickly as you expect. Allow me to give you some examples that are going to make you sad. How long was Moses in the wilderness from the time that God called him to do something until the time that he got to do it or got to see it done? 40 years. 40 years. What about Joseph, who had a dream that he would rule the nations, and then he did rule the nations? Guess how long it was in between? 14 years. Like, I don't like that part of the Bible at all. I get it. We read earlier about, or we talked earlier a little bit about King David. When King David was anointed to be king by the prophet, you're going to be king, it was somewhere between 10 and 12 years later before he was king. God is not in a hurry, folks. He is not in a hurry at all. And when we get ourselves in a hurry, we miss out on many of the things that he's doing. You see, here's what happened in my life. I think this is true of many of us, is that in the beginning, when we feel like we're doing something of value, more so than we might realize, it's about us. It's about us. We have a tendency to, I'm going to get this job because it's going to make me feel better about me, and other people are going to like me and think I've been successful. I'm going to get this education. I'm going to marry this person. I'm going to have this family. And more often than we might realize, there's a lot of me in that. There's a whole lot of me in the motive, right? And then what happens is you find yourself hitting a brick wall, falling down, not facing what you thought, not getting to the success as quickly as expected, not quite liking what you thought you would love as much as you expected to, and you find yourself starting over. And it's in the process of starting over that we end up realizing that this is not about me, this is about him. This is about him. The challenge is for you and I to start focusing on honoring and glorifying God with our life instead of trying to be successful with God with our life. Just listen to Christian teaching. And I'm talking about not so good Christian teaching. Here's what you will find. Many of us treat God like the newest way to win. You know, like the newest process that gets you what you want. And in the long run, man, we miss completely that God is not a means to our end. He is the beginning. He is the end. He is it. Right? That's why he said to Moses, "My name is I am that I am. I am. And I want you, I love you, I care about you, and I want to utilize anything and everything to help you become the person you were created to be, a person that brings honor and glory to God with their life." Would you pray with me? Father, we are so tempted to believe myths or lies or to operate in a way that's not helpful or good, to simply go through experiences but not learn from them, to not put over them the lens that is the truth of your word. Lord, we have a tendency to have experiences but not confess those experiences to wisdom, to let wise people in our life speak truth into us. We have a tendency, Lord, to think we learned a quick lesson, therefore it will be better next time, and thinking that just because I know, that means I will do better. We have a tendency, Lord, to think that we need to hurry, that we feel like we're losing time, that things are being wasted, that in some way Every day that we have not gotten back where we were or accomplished what we want, that is a day that's lost. But Lord, we miss the reality that you are working in those moments and that we need to be patient and rest and know that you are God. We trust you, Lord. But we're also learning to trust you more than we do. And I pray that you would use the pain that we face in life to be glorified, but to grow us, to transform and renew us. I pray for those who are beginning again, who are starting over. Whether it's a relationship, an addiction, whether it's a job, an educational, scholastic thing. Maybe it's their faith. Just simply starting over in faith. Lord, I pray that you would guide and direct each and every one of us and that we would listen to you and follow you. In your name we pray today. Amen. Amen. Ushers, if you'd join me down front. While they're preparing to do this, let me just mention that response to God is something we do every day. We respond to what he's taught us or what he's doing in us in hundreds of different ways. And today, I encourage you to respond to him in a couple of particular ways. That you might first respond to him by being more welcoming to the time that it takes to grow in Christ and mature. Give yourself time. Take the time. I just want to encourage you to give it time. Now, that can mean a few things. That can mean being willing to wait days, weeks, months, years. But that can also mean being intentional about those days, weeks, months, and years. Give it time. I can't tell you the number of times someone has said to me, I just don't understand the Bible. And I say, when's the last time you read it? And they say, I don't remember. Let's give it some time, you know? Let's dedicate some time to his word. Let's spend some time with one another. Let's pray together and celebrate and discuss and converse and let God teach us through those experiences and through those things. I encourage you to do that. Also, obviously, we respond to the Lord with generosity. You guys as a church are growing so rapidly in your generosity. I'm so thankful for your attitude and your heart and your willingness to sacrifice and to give. And so I'm sure that today will be no different than that. And let's pray and just thank God for this offering, and we'll move throughout the end of the gathering. Lord, we trust you. Take this offering and do with it as you wish. Change our hearts in the process of giving. In your name we pray. Amen. As we're finalizing that, a couple of things that I want to tell you about, and then something very important we would like to do. Keep in mind that next week we are going to have a moment at the end of the gathering where we vote on something. I mentioned last week that an investor had offered to buy some property from us. Our leadership team has investigated this. We believe that it's the right decision. We believe that unanimously. Because of the ministry that this will free up. But we will discuss that, and that is a church decision that will be made next week. So church members will be asked to be here and consider that, prayerfully look into it. We put orange cones around the corners and stuff out front so you could see that piece of property. Feel free to look at that as you exit today, and you'll know next week what it is that we're talking about, okay? If you have any questions, that's not a big secret, by the way. You're welcome to talk to a leadership team member or come to me. If you were not able to be here this past Wednesday, we kind of unveiled the whole plan this past Wednesday at Bible study, so lots of folks are kind of aware of what's happening and what's developing there. So if you'd like to know more, you're certainly welcome to talk to one of those folks or to come to me. I'd love to tell you all about it. We will tell you all about it in detail next Sunday, okay? So the next thing you need to know is that tonight at 5 o'clock at Majestic Steakhouse is the next 111 gathering. Now, we've done this a few different ways. Let me clarify about this tonight. Tonight, you show up at 5. You get the buffet if you want to eat. You get the buffet. The food is fantastic. I don't know what they'll have tonight. Last time we did it, they had ribs and meatloaf and like, it's like your grandmother just gave you everything she makes that's awesome. Like, it was fantastic. The meal was somewhere between 10 and 12 bucks last time. I don't remember the exact price, but somewhere in that neighborhood. But that's tonight at 5 o'clock. And the topic of conversation is this morning's message, specifically the three areas. So we're going to talk about things like, have you ever rushed God and moved too quickly into a decision that ended up costing you? You know, you love to tell that story. Like, have you ever found yourself not learning from your experiences and therefore recreating them over and over? So it will be, I think it will be entertaining. I think it will be enjoyable. I think you will get to know people well. That's 5 o'clock tonight. It's Dutch, so you're buying your own meal. You guys come, do that. Lots of folks are concerned that they haven't signed up, and I'm telling you, you do not have to, okay? The one we do in Ledbetter, you have to sign up because we have to tell them a week ahead of time how many people are coming. But the one in Mayfield is not like that. It's a buffet. It's open. We might have 15 people there. We might have 35 people there. It's okay. You guys come on and be a part of that tonight at 5, okay? It'll be over around 6:30, I would anticipate. People have asked, can I bring my kids? You can certainly bring your kids. You can certainly do that. I will tell you that you're going to be at tables of 6, and you're going to be having adult conversation, and you need to be able to focus on that. And so it might bore the heck out of your kids, and they might wish you had not brought them, okay? That's just honest. If they're old enough that they can sit at a table by themselves and play a game or something, you might consider that. If you have a babysitter, a grandparent, neighbor that you trust, you might want to consider that as well for their sake, not really for anybody else's, but it is adult-focused conversation, okay? I'm excited because Tyson Lindsay is leading tonight, and this is the first time somebody besides me has led one of these gatherings, and we've been looking for the opportunity to do that, and Tyson's going to knock it out of the park. He's going to do a fantastic job, and you guys, if for no other reason, you ought to come and just support him in that endeavor, getting to lead that moment, okay? So that's tonight. Let me tell you about two other things that will be done today. We are honoring two people today, and two people who have served the church honorably and who deserve our respect for that. First, the role of treasurer at our church in the past has been a fairly hefty volunteer job. Now we have a financial advisory team, so 3 or 4 people who help the treasurer. Now we've given my assistant Darlene hours of her week to be a financial secretary, so she's doing a lot of the legwork and things. So Beth Schmidt, who's now our treasurer, is doing a phenomenal job, but quite frankly, she has a little bit of an easier job than our previous treasurer did because so much has been delegated, okay? Terry Osucha was the treasurer here for 2.5, almost 3 years. During that time, did most all of the work that goes with the job and did so to the very best of her ability with a great attitude the entire time. And we are very thankful to her for that. Terry, I know that you're not a come up front and let's all look at you kind of gal, but we have a gift for you and we would love to pray for you. Is it okay if you'll come up here and join me? You guys, I invite you to just say thank you to her if you could.
And to tell me you do.
We like to surprise people. We like to surprise people. There is a gift, someone here. Yeah, Rachel. So I know we have a gift for you. And Rachel is the angel who put all this together and did such a good job with it. But on behalf of the church, thank you for the many, many hours and days and weeks that you put into this job. We love you.
Thank you.
You guys, once again, there. And then also, you guys know that our new children's pastor is here today. I don't think he's in this room. I think he's next door. But Cody Foreman has been the director of children's ministry here for over 5 years. And where is Cody? Come on up here, Cody. Joe, you join her, man. Y'all come up here. One of our kids' classes wanted to see this, so they've come in to observe. 5.5 years, you guys, that's quite a while. I'm supposed to move you this way. I've got you in the dark area over there. So let me tell you about kids ministry, okay? Kids ministry is one of the most challenging areas of leadership, because you're asking people to volunteer in areas that they come to church to escape. You know what I'm saying? Like you have your kids all week long, and then you bring them here and drop them in a nursery, and oftentimes the last thing somebody wants to do is walk in there and do that. And that's unfortunate, but it's a reality that she faces in this particular role. And so she has been trainer, motivator, administrator, reminder, and even like quality control oversight. Like, she's had all of those things and has done so for 5.5 years with the greatest of attitude. And if I could brag on Cody most, I would say that the number one area of her life is her heart and her attitude, because when she says that your kids are her kids, and I even tried to get her not to say that, I'm like, that is way too much pressure to take on yourself, girl. Don't do that. Here's what it is. I'm telling you, like, when your kids are hurting, she's hurting. Like, when they're needing somebody to pray for them, she's praying for them. And her love for children that are not her biological children or not her adopted children, or her love for other people's kids is really top-notch. It's really top-notch. And for all things, like, we could look at children's ministry, your children have benefited because they had another person in their life that loved them like that. You get that? So if you would you please say thank you to her for that? And we have a gift for you too, so you guys come on up here. We asked Joe because the truth is, Joe's the volunteer that always serves. Like he's always there, and obviously they're a team. I mean, what presentation skills you have, guys. Good job,
you guys.
So this is a wall hanging for their home, and all the kids are signing it. And we're going to make sure all of them there are some who haven't gotten to do it yet. All those kids are going to get to sign it as well. So we also gave everybody some gift certificates so they can go and enjoy themselves in places. So thank you guys very much. We appreciate you. All right, you guys. Voting on a big decision next week. It's a really exciting thing God's doing there. Tonight is 1:11 at 5:00 in Mayfield. If you're available, you ought to be there. It's going to be a great night. You'll get to know people better. You will become part of the church in a real relational way quicker, and I encourage you to do that. I hope you have a fantastic week, everybody. I love you. Goodbye.